Good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's service. This is Christ the King Day. And if you're aware of the church calendar, you'll know this is the last day of the year in terms of church calendars. We begin a new calendar year next Sunday as we start with Advent. Christ the King Day is a celebration that is a relatively new one that began around about 1925 when one of the popes decided that it was a good thing to mark out a day that just reminded us that Jesus is the King of all creation. And it came as an aftermath of the troubles of after World War I and the period of the Depression, when people were feeling that the world was maybe politically unstable and that there were a whole range of new leaders emerging in the world. And so it was put onto the church calendar, both of the Catholic and the evangelical calendars, that this Sunday would be marked as Christ the King Sunday. I do welcome you at home. If you're watching today, we're trying to adjust sound levels. I'm going to try and speak a little bit slower because some people said they had some trouble listening at home. And we're also adjusting the levels. That may mean that for the people who are here in church, you may think that the noise is loud. So we're trying to capture as much sound as we can on the camera that's being used here. So if you do, you might just have to adjust your hearing aids. And if you don't wear hearing aids, you better bring cotton balls to put into your ears. So I hope it won't be too much of an adjustment for everybody all around. We start today with our call to worship, which is based on Psalm 100, and it is responsive. Let us come into God's presence with singing. Let us make a joyful noise and worship God gladly. That's, of course, going to be quite difficult today because we can't sing, but we can still sing in our hearts. We enter this place with thanksgiving because we know that the Lord to whom we belong is our shepherd and king. God's steadfast love and faithfulness endures forever. Come, let us worship God with praise and joy, giving thanks in our hearts. Amen. And our prayer of confession today. As in Ezekiel's time, many of today's leaders are not good shepherds. They exploit the weak and drive people away. But God, you don't mean that we do that now. We ask you, God, surely we're not driving people away from here. We confess at times we do look after ourselves and ignore others. We can focus on Jesus here in this place and fail to see Christ outside. God, forgive us when we become so fixed on our priorities that we fail to see Jesus in the hungry and thirsty, the stranger, the naked, the sick, or those in prison. Forgive us the times we fail to act with love, justice, and mercy. God, remind us of your kingdom values of love, peace, and justice. Jesus said, truly I tell you, just as you did to one of the least of these brothers or sisters, you did it to me. Amen. And our declaration of forgiveness today is based on 1 Peter chapter 2, 24. Jesus himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, we have been healed. For we were going astray like sheep, but now have been returned to the shepherd and guardian of our souls. Hear the good news. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. And on the strength of that, those of you that are able, please stand. Those of you at home will be singing, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow.
Thank you.
It will be so good to sing Christmas carols with our lungs bursting this year, isn't it? It's so weird to be standing there mouthing out the words when you really want to sing along. Our readings this morning will be brought to us by Yvonne Morey.
So from Ezekiel. For this is what the Sovereign Lord says, I myself will search for my sheep and look after them. As a shepherd looks after his scattered flock when he is with them, so will I after my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places where they are scattered on a day of clouds and darkness. I'll bring them out from the nations and gather them from the countries. I'll bring them into their own land. I will pasture them on the mountains of Israel, in the ravines, in all the settlements in the land. I will tend them in a good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel will be their grazing land. There they will lie down in good grazing land. There they will feed in a rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will tend my sheep and have them lie down, declares the Sovereign Lord. I will search for the lost and bring back the strays. I will bind up the injured and strengthen the weak. But the sleek and the strong I will destroy. I will shepherd the flock with justice. Therefore, this is what the Lord says to them. See, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep. Because you show with flank and shoulder, butting all the weak sheep with your thorns until you have driven them away, I will save my flock, and they will no longer be plundered. I will judge between one sheep and another. I will place over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will tend them. He will tend them and be their shepherd. I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David will be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. Gospel reading from Matthew. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. I was the stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? Or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? Where did we see you sick in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, and into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you didn't invite me in. I needed clothes, you didn't clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me. Well, they also will say, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and didn't help you? He will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me. Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The parables in Matthew speak of a time not long before Jesus went to the cross. He sat on the Mount of Olives with his disciples, and in a private moment, they asked him about the end of the age and how to inherit the kingdom. Jesus shared with them the things that will take place and the sign of his coming. He talked about the great tribulation and the fact that no one knows the day or hour of his coming except the Father in heaven. Jesus explains that at an appointed time of the Father, there will be a separation of those who have received him and those who have rejected him. And this is the Bible passage that was read to us this morning. You'll recall that last week I said Jesus had been talking to the crowds and the disciples, and there were several warnings. One was to watch, another was to be ready, and today it is Jesus, the Son of Man, is coming back. He's coming with his holy angels in all his glory. Jesus the King will call together the nations, the tribes, the peoples of this world. Jesus is describing the ultimate judgment of all time. This isn't limited to first century Jews or Gentiles, or even just religious people. It specifically says all the nations. He gives specific criteria for how he is going to separate all people into two categories, for those who enter God's kingdom and those who don't. He will sort out the world, and the image he uses is of sheep and goats. To the sheep he will say, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. We all know that inheritance cannot be earned. It's a gift. The legal right is determined by identity. Usually it's the spouse or the children or the family of the person deceased. As Christians through Jesus, we are adopted into God's family. We inherit the identity of Jesus and his relationship with God the Father. We become a child of God. Through our identity in Jesus, his inheritance becomes our inheritance. His sheep inherit the kingdom. All those who receive Jesus and acknowledge his right to rule in our lives are his sheep. As his sheep, we live in his eternal kingdom, prepared before the foundation of the world, and so exquisitely described in Psalm 139, where it reminds us that Jesus has known us when we were being knit together in our mother's womb. This has always been God's plan, even though we as humans rebel. We're weak and we fail. Jesus makes it very clear we cannot earn or possess his kingdom through good works. God has blessed us and brought us into his family and kingdom through receiving Jesus. The outworking of his kingdom within us is how we see each other and live our relationships. Before we look more closely at the passage, a few words about sheep and goats. Here is a sheep, and this is a goat, and this is a sheep and a goat. They are obviously different. Anyone can tell them apart. But in first century Palestine, there wasn't such a difference. Today, certain breeds of sheep are bred because we want their soft and fluffy wool for lovely fabrics. But when Jesus spoke, it wasn't quite so easy to tell a sheep from a goat by just taking a quick look. You had to watch their actions. A goat behaves very differently from a sheep. Sheep follow their shepherd. Goats do their own thing. Sheep avoid obstacles. Goats eat them. There is a saying that shepherds protect their sheep from the environment. Goat herders protect the environment from their sheep, from their goats. Jesus said he would separate all the peoples of the world the way sheep and goats were separated, by their behavior, by their actions. Behavior determines outcomes. Let's look at this then in a scriptural context. This is the third story we've looked at this month during the weekly sermons. The first story was the parable about the 10 women, 5 of whom behaved wisely and 5 who didn't. They were ultimately judged according to their behavior. The second story was of the businessman who gave three of his employees different amounts of money, of resources, and then he leaves them. And when he comes back, 2 of them who invested his resources are praised, and the third one is punished because he did nothing with what he was given. The scriptural context here is behavior determines outcomes. So what is the behavioral criteria Jesus says he will use to separate the world? I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger and you invited me to your home. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you cared for me. I was in prison and you visited me. These are all acts of kindness. Notice Jesus does not say, you sympathized when I was hungry, and you sympathized when I was thirsty. The clear message is Jesus will separate all people based on whether or not they have practiced acts of kindness. Let's be clear though, this is not a statement to support the idea that we are saved by good works. This would be to take this passage out of the context of the Bible. It must be interpreted alongside other scriptures. Romans 10 verse 9 makes it very clear. If you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That is very clear and very different than the text in Matthew. It's these apparent contradictions that keep theologians in a job, and Bible scholars certainly employed, to make us as Christians put on our thinking caps as we reconcile different parts of Scripture. Salvation comes as we openly declare that Jesus is Lord. But this text in Matthew forces us to have a significant respect for, and a need for, and an appreciation for, and even a requirement for acts of kindness. Kindness matters. Kindness is Jesus's criteria for who inherits the kingdom and who does not. That's a pretty radical statement. Paul the Apostle says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32, be kind and compassionate to each other, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. There it is. It can't be made any clearer. Be kind to each other. And that's a radical action and thought. Being kind is radically different to the behaviour we see demonstrated in our local community, in our country, and even by Christians. How can kindness help? Good question. None of us can do everything, but each of us can do something. I call it washing the elephant. The problems are big, too big, like an elephant looming over us. But I can do something. I can wash the part of the elephant that's just there in front of me. I can't do much, but I can do something. I think if we match up the verses that call us to be kind with those that say we need to openly declare that Jesus is Lord, we find that we are called to have faith that demonstrates the goodness and the godness of Jesus through acts of kindness. It's a bit like a hula hoop. You'll remember hula hoops. With a hula hoop, you have everything inside the hoop, outside the hoop, and the hoop itself. Kindness has these same three elements: inner kindness, outer kindness, and shared kindness. Outer kindness is everything outside the hula hoop. Outer kindness is what we do for others without their participation. If you like, it's that golden rule in Matthew chapter 7. In everything, do to others what you would have them do to you, for this sums up the law and the prophet. Outside kindness is a one-way act. There is no commitment on the part of the receiver. You donate money to a charity or a Christian mission to build schools and hospitals overseas. Or you might have seen in some of the local cafes, there's a jar where you can leave some money for the price of a cup of coffee, and the barista will give a free cup of coffee to a homeless person who comes into the store. You never meet the receiver, but it's an act of kindness. Inner kindness is everything inside the circle. This is the kindness in us. It's described in Proverbs 4, chapter 23. Above all else, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. It is our kindness towards ourselves and also how we think about others. And the third is the shared kindness, represented by the circle of the hoop itself. It's done with others, alongside them, together. Ecclesiastes has this lovely description in chapter 4. Though one person may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. But a cord of three strands is not so easily broken. Shared kindness is a two-way interaction, an engagement. Here is where transformation comes in. Jesus makes it personal. Every example Jesus gave to identify and separate people who inherit his kingdom are his examples of shared kindness. I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger and you invited me into your home. I was sick and you cared for me. I was in prison and you visited me. That's a thought we need to let sink in. Jesus holds his followers accountable to share acts of kindness with others. There's no hidden agenda. Acts of kindness are a natural outworking of the supernatural transformation of the love of God in our hearts. It's simple things. It's greeting people we know and people we don't know. It might be as we go for a walk. It might be somebody in the supermarket. You know what I mean. It's counting to three inside your head before speaking or interrupting another person's conversation. Pausing, listening more, talking less. Believe me, that's a skill I really need to develop. My 92-year-old aunt tells me she doesn't talk about her health to her acquaintances anymore because before she's finished saying anything, they've already jumped in to finish her sentence and then start describing their own woes. Sound familiar? It's a human trait. Ecclesiastes chapter 5 reminds us, guard your steps when you go to the house of God. Go near to listen rather than to offer the sacrifice of fools who do not know what they do wrong. Do not be quick with your mouth. Do not be hasty with your heart or utter anything before God. God is in heaven and you are on earth, so let your words be few. Pausing gives us time to listen, to give space to the other person and to ourselves, to be a little gentler and to demonstrate kindness. It sounds simple, doesn't sound particularly religious, and we may be tempted to ask, so what's so Christian about any of that I've just said? Well, that's what the disciples asked Jesus to. And he replied, then these righteous ones will reply, Lord, when did we ever see you hungry and feed you? Or thirsty and give you something to drink? Or a stranger and show you hospitality? Or naked and give you clothing? When did we ever see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king will say, I tell you the truth, when you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me. That's a compelling reason for us to practice kindness. Amen. As we stay seated, the next song is one that I hope you might be able to use as a reflection as you think about your relationship with God, and basically we need to give thanks with a grateful heart.
Jesus Christ.
To pass the plate around. So if you have brought your offertory today, there is a plate in the foyer as you leave, if you could put your envelope there, or you may have given already this week online. So for those gifts that have been given, let's say together this offertory prayer. Eternal God, we offer to you these gifts and our lives. May Christ rule in our lives, so that we are powerful witnesses to the truth of your kingdom of love, justice, mercy, and peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And Elizabeth's going to bring to us the announcements today.
Good morning. Welcome to worship to all here and wherever you may be watching the service. Today I just wanted to once again say thank you to all those who attended yesterday's consultation meeting with the Church Council, and thank you for your support of Church Council, the Elders and the JNC. That certainly is very encouraging. For those who attended the meeting yesterday, you may recall at the end of the meeting I asked if people were willing to commit our congregational regeneration to prayer, and it was great to see everyone in attendance agree that you would indeed commit that to prayer. So I'll be working with the Elders and Church Council Executive over the coming week or two to further explore how we can turn our focus on prayer. But in the meantime, I'd invite you all, if you would like to start that commitment to prayer about our future here at Benora Point, perhaps I'd like to suggest that at 7:30 a.m, because it's not on the o'clock, at 7:30 a.m. every Monday morning, so Monday mornings, 7:30 a.m, I invite you, wherever you are, whatever you're doing, you might be having your breakfast or walking around the lake, or like me, heading off to work. So today my challenge is an invitation to everyone, every Monday at 7:30 a.m, to take a few moments to pray specifically for our congregational regeneration. Thank you.
Well, working from one lectern is like shuffling a deck of cards up here just to find the right page. Before we move into our time of prayer today, I just wanted to draw your attention to a couple of personal items to the congregation here. Some of you will have known either through Twin Towns Uniting or Eleanora Uniting, or through the work of the Wesley Mission, the Reverend Brian Whitlock. Brian was in hospital a couple of weeks ago and had made a great recovery after two quite serious operations. And when I last saw him, he was fighting fit, and we've been working on his memoirs. And last Saturday evening, a week ago, he had a fall in the bathroom and hit his head on the tiles and was taken to John Flynn Hospital in intensive care and put on life support systems until his family could all gather together. And last Sunday afternoon, around about 2:30, Brian died. So it's very unexpected and obviously quite shattering for June, his wife. The funeral will be tomorrow at Alandi Gardens at Narang, but it will be a private funeral because of the COVID restrictions. But the Whitlock family is intending to have a memorial celebratory service, probably at Eleanora Uniting Church, sometime in late January, when the restrictions have eased and the family from interstate can come and join them. But if you do know the Whitlocks, if you could keep June, her son Paul, and daughter Jill and their families in your prayer at this time. Another personal item for us here, please continue to pray for Barbara and Ray Murphy. I've been in touch with Ray during the week and I've seen Barbara, and the doctors have said that her time is now quite limited, probably less than 5 weeks. Unfortunately, her memory is going, and so it's when family have come to visit, she hasn't always remembered whether people are there or not. Ray has asked that we just keep that for the family in their prayers, and they're going to basically limit the visitors to their immediate family. I was talking to Jean Annette during the week. Jack is in Tweed Hospital. He was in emergency, but they've moved him to a ward. His health issues at the moment means that Jack will not be coming home. So Jean is now in the position with her family of needing to find some other long-term residential care for Jack. And she's quite emotional as well, you can imagine, this week, trying to just juggle the realities of what's happened and planning for the future. So please keep her in your prayers as well. Again, because of COVID, but also because Jack is, his health is up and down each day. She's asked if you would just pray. There won't be visitors to see him for the time being. And another family that I'd ask you to pray for, who you don't know, but that doesn't matter because our prayers count. Julie Richards, who's in our congregation and been coming for the last couple of weeks, has been involved with a family in Wollongong, the family of a young lady called Libby. You probably would have heard in the news a couple of weeks ago about a young woman who was killed because a car driven by a young driver and a young passenger mounted the footpath and killed her instantly. And that is Libby and her family. So if this morning we could keep Libby in our prayers as well, her family, I should say, as well in our prayers this morning. Again, one of those tragic things that just is so unexpected, and also tragic because not only does it affect Libby's family and extended friends, but it affects that young driver and the stupid passenger that they were doing ridiculous things in the car. And so they've, you know, had this devastating effect on so many families. So if you would keep them in your prayers this morning. And Bruce is going to lead us in our prayers for the people today.
Thank you. So as we come to our time to pray for others, during the prayers, when you hear the words, "Your kingdom come," your response will be, "Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." I believe that's on the screen. So let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ for all those in need of our compassion and care, including those that Debbie's just mentioned to us, for all those who commit themselves to the poorest and for those who are afraid to be involved. Lord, we trust that you help us serve you in and through people. For all those who've lost their way in life and who look for a welcoming place in the church, who look for your good news to live by, we pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth." For all people driven from their homes, for the many victims of war and civil strife, for all strangers living in foreign lands, we pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth." For all those who hunger for food, who thirst for justice, who crave for human dignity, we cry out that we may hear your voice in them, and we pray, "Your kingdom come, for all those who care for the sick and the handicapped, for doctors, nurses, pharmacists, midwives, we cry out that we may recognise you in those who need affectionate, loving care. And so we pray, "Your kingdom come." For all those who are imprisoned because of their convictions, for all those who are persecuted, who are prisoners of their hatred, their greed, or their failings, we cry out. And so we pray, "Your kingdom come. The voices that cry out to us, the eyes that plead with us, may we recognise you in them, Lord, and love you in them. So we pray, "Your kingdom come." And so we pray, as Jesus taught us, and are confident to pray, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen."
And our benediction for today. As you have been fed, go to feed the hungry. As you have been set free, go to set free the imprisoned. As you have been received, give. As you have heard, proclaim. And the blessing which you have received from God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you always. Amen. Amen. So now, go out into the community of Benora and Tweed Heads to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen. You might have noticed during the service that we didn't have the psalm reading this morning as a spoken word. And that's because I found a musical version of Psalm 100 from a choir in Brooklyn. So it's a very big, majestic way of singing Psalm 100. So I hope that you will enjoy this musical rendition of Psalm 100. I am encouraged by the fact that King David, when he wrote the Psalms, had the idea of putting them to music anyway. We're the ones who just tend to say them as words. So here we have it in a musical version. Just a reminder that the exit for church, for those who are new, is through the doorway here. We can't have morning tea because of the COVID restrictions, but there is a small group of people who go up to the Benora Twin Towns Club if you would like to join with that group to have a cup of coffee, to have a conversation after church. You're more than welcome.